here as the quality level in my product when I keep on improving. How do I improve my quality level? By doing more of prevention and more of appraisal activity. Am I correct? I do more prevention and more appraisal. So my cost is more, but the advantage what I get is my quality improves. Customer, you know, experience improves. But when the quality levels are low, very frequently my product will be failing. Failure cost is at the high. Why? Because I have not done prevention and appraisal properly. I spent less. My quality level is low. So my product is failing very frequently. And so failure cost is more. So as I improve the quality level, the failure cost is coming down. Do you understand both the graph? This is cost of good quality curve. This is cost of poor quality curve. Am I right?
Yes. Yeah.
Now I combine both. That means I add up both the cost and then I plot it. That is called total quality cost. That is called total quality cost. This total quality cost is taking a turn here. It comes down gradually. And after this point, it starts going up. What is this telling me? This is giving me a clue that I must achieve at least this level of quality. Achieve this level of quality, every quality improvement activity I do, my profit will get maximized. You understand? Up to this point, any improvement activity, any improvement project I do, that will help me improve my profit. So I must do it at least up to this. Clear? Beyond which, I may improve the quality, but that may not help me improve the profit. So I will not do this unless there is a compelling reason. Do you all understand? So at least you must maintain this level of quality. This is called optimum quality level or acceptable quality level. But if there is a compelling reason, then I need to go beyond this point also. In order to understand how the profit is maximized, yes, you understood about prevention. These are prevention activity. You understood about appraisal. And now,
this so is just one slide behind, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, now, this this graph, red color graph, is my cost of quality. This green color graph is my revenue. And now, at particular point, the gap between the revenue and the cost is very high. That's the point where my profit is maximized. This is what I said. This point is called optimum quality or acceptable quality. When I go beyond, product quality is going better and better. But what happens to my profit? Starts reducing. No company will like that happening, isn't it? And nobody would like to compromise the profit because of the improvement efforts. So don't do this unless there is a compelling reason. What is a compelling reason? Your competitors are maintaining a better quality level and yours is low. And that's a compelling reason. You must go for it, maybe even at the expense of profit. Because now, more than the profit, the better strategy is, you capture a bigger market and then later on you can, somehow compensate it. So this is how you need to work. So there is something called cost alignment. There is cost associated with assurance related activities, prevention activities, appraisal activities. And in spite of all these things, there will be cost associated with failure. And when I don't spend here properly, probably the assurance and prevention, I may lose heavily here. Instead of that, my suggestion to all of you is, prefer spending more on assurance and prevention. That way, your appraisal cost can come down and then failure cost can come down drastically. What is the point, checking too many things? Checking, by checking, you don't achieve anything. Instead of, increasing the inspection and checking, prevent the problem. Do more of prevention. Six Sigma is a defect prevention technique. Your product doesn't require more inspection. Quality, is built at source. So inspection can be minimized. That's why appraisal cost is going down, failure cost is going down, and the difference will directly add up to your profit. And this rule will also be helpful. 1-10-100 rule. What is this 1-10-100 rule? I spend 1 rupee in prevention, that will help me save 10 rupee in correction. That will also help me save 100 rupee in the failure. But if I am conjuice enough and then I try to save this 1 rupee, how much I may lose? I may lose 110 rupees. You can decide which can be good for your company. Right? This is called cost alignment. So which of the following best describe internal failure cost? You can tell me which is the best definition of.
The unavoidable quality system costs associated with the production of any product or service.
Unavoidable cost associated with production of
opposite of external failure cost.
No,
opposite of external failure cost. It's a good definition. Any last opinion? The last cost, one.
The cost resulting from a non-conformance detected before the product or service is provided.
Detected before the product or service is provided.
Very good. This is what we learned, isn't it? See, sometimes what happens, multiple answers may exist. As a green belt, you must go for the best one. It draws a clear boundary before dispatch and after dispatch, or before you provide the service or after you provide the service. So the fourth one is the best definition. It's very crystal clear. So what is the advantage when I reduce the, you know, when I reduce the sigma level, or when I increase the when I increase the sigma level, what happens to the defect? It keeps on decreasing. See, two sigma level means 68% good. Sorry, two sigma level means 98% good. 98% good. And three sigma level means 99% good. And then four sigma, five sigma, six sigma. 99.999 into 6. There are certain numbers. We'll learn that later. As I keep on increasing my sigma level, you see my defect levels are going down. Initially it were very high, 20 to 45% of my, you know, sales I lose because of cost of poor belt. When I bring the sigma level to higher thing, the defects are limited to 3.4 dpm more. And that means my cost of poor quality is brought below 1% of the revenue. Right? So every additional sigma level, cost of quality will at least decrease by 10%. It's like a kind of empirical relationship based on the experience people have found. And please note, sigma level is not calculated at the organization level. Sigma level is not calculated at the product level. Sigma level is calculated at the process level. And to be frank, sigma level is calculated at the CTQ level. At what level? CTQ level. Now tell me, one product, how many CTQs are possible? Come on. For one product, how many CTQs are possible? Maybe 100?
Maybe more.
Maybe more, yes. 100 CTQs may be there. The technical specification written in the product, sometimes it will run in one. And a company may have hundreds of products. So improving the sigma level is not that easy, right? Just to reach to the product level, you must reach the sigma level of at least, you know, all the CTQs associated with the product. There is enormous opportunity exists for improvement. Every CTQ needs to be, you know, measured in terms of sigma level and should be improved. So that is why we call sigma, Six Sigma as a process level approach. It doesn't work like your ISO. ISO creates system. Six Sigma checks whether the system can deliver result or not. What is important is the second one is important. So what do we understood here in the step number one? We understood that proper understanding of the core business process, alignment of improvement efforts and strategic goals and policy deployment system are important while identifying a project. If you are competent enough, do that. Otherwise, join with the team who can help you with this. You can equip you as a black belt, and then you can start doing it by yourself. It's not that difficult, but some effort should go in that direction. Some additional tools and techniques needs to be mastered by properly learning it. And then the champions, master black belts and black belts, and then the green belts also are part of the project team, and then they will identify the Lean Six Sigma projects. It can be top down or it can be bottom up. But what is important is alignment. At the operational level means down level. That means the approach is now bottom up. What the people face as a problem in the down level, they are considered as project, right? And that can be the bottom up approach. You can do it easily using these tools: voice of customer, voice of business, cost of poor quality. Don't worry about the strategic goals of the company and all. Just talk to your people, talk to the customers, talk to the business leader, and measure the cost of poor quality with available data. And if you understand there is a severe pain people are experiencing, that's an improvement opportunity. And then someone has to measure the alignment. I mean, understand the alignment. A CTQ tree is a tool.
1 minute, I'll switch on the power.
Yeah. A CTQ tree is a tool that will help you to translate the vague statements made by the customer, nothing but the VOC, into easy to measure measure, easy to measure metrics, right? And they are called the CTQ. Voice of customer will get converted into CTQ, voice of business will get converted into CTB. And cost of quality includes prevention, appraisal, internal failure cost, external failure cost. The first two together are called cost of good quality. The internal and external failure together are called cost of poor quality. If you don't do the good quality, spend cost of good quality, then cost of poor quality will happen. If you don't control the internal failures, then external failures will amplify like anything. Right? So a lot of inspection and all those things you need to do to improve your effectiveness. But doing inspection itself is a wasteful activity. So do more of prevention and appraisal, and thereby you can minimize your internal failures also, right? Reducing the internal failure can make the external failures a rare event, right? That's why, the proactive approach of detecting the failures and then solving the problems at the root level is very, very important. In fact, that is one of the most important pillar of operational excellence. So that's it from me about this step number one, how to identify problems.